Welcome back to this morning. Can you please stand? And let's go begin this morning by going to the Lord in prayer together as we get started. I think a better way to start this morning. Let's go to prayer together. Father, we thank you, God, as always, so much for this time, Lord. And we just want to begin our service this morning with our minds focused upon you. And God, just take time out to recognize your presence here this morning. That God, we're not just here to talk about you or to sing about you, but God, we're here to really meet with you. To meet with one another, of course, but God, primarily to meet with you. And Father, God, we thank you for this time, God, how that we are taking time out from this world and recognize how easy it is to just get caught up in our daily routines and kind of the rat race of just going through the motions and checking things off our list, and we can lose days of our lives, weeks, months, years, decades. But God, we thank you for this time, God. We have this time that is transcendent, that it allows us to step outside of our routine a little bit this morning and to focus upon you, to examine our lives, not just the decisions we make, the things that we do, but to look at why we do what we do. Just to look at our life, God, from an eternal perspective, a transcendent perspective, God. That's what this is about this morning. And I pray, God, that you would help us to see that. You would help us, God, to see where we're at with you this morning. And God, if there's anything between us and you, God, that we would get that settled this morning, that we would repent, that God, we would draw close to you. And God, our desire always, as we come like together like this, is that we all leave here, to whatever extent, we all leave here closer to you than how we came in. So God, that's our goal, that's our prayer this morning, that would happen. God, I thank you so much for every single person who's here this morning. This is such a blessing to be here together with this group of people this morning. And God, we thank you for this time. We pray your blessing upon it now. We pray for your presence, your power, your Holy Spirit to be felt during this time. During this time, as we sing to you, as we hear your word, as everything takes place this morning, God, that you would be glorified in all these things. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Yes. Grab a red book if you found one back there. Church young. It's a big one around this door of the seats. She can find one. Let's turn to page 190. Same song. We sold it to the hospital this morning. Same song. Can't help but think of this. Jesus has been uploaded for 3 years plus, and we know that. We only really have a lot of knowledge of him from the time he's early born. And at 12 years old, we have another wedding. You better hear much more about him when he's 30 years old. But I'll guarantee you, he lived those years. And we have no idea what all he went through during those times. He gave us what we need. This song here says he passed this way before. I guarantee he's went through things that we know nothing about. He's experienced things that you and I experience sometimes. We wonder, we're the only one in the whole world ever experienced. I'll show you someone else's experience, and Jesus experienced as well. And listen to what we're saying today. Jesus passed this way before. Everyone join in. Joy to me, this Lord has given. Jesus passed this way before, all the way from earth to heaven. Jesus passed this way before. Though the clouds are heavy o'er me, heavy o'er me, and the gone, the way before me. This hand filled my soul with singing, so with singing, Jesus passed this way before. Does the road seem rough and weary? Jesus passed this way before. Does the night seem dark and dreary? Jesus passed this way before.
So we're singing, Jesus passed this way before.
good to know that we have a Savior this morning, and not only provides for us, but He's experienced the things that we're experiencing, and He has the knowledge of what we're going through today. This next song slows it down quite a bit. It's all been around for many, many years, and I think everybody here probably knows it. And I think you really enjoy it. Beautiful Life, page 174. And we'll join in.
Thank you. one way. This one's also about Jesus and the hope that we have in him. That's our only hope is in Christ. That's what this song says. In Christ alone is where our hope is. He's our cornerstone, our foundation, and we can only hope in him.
Message. I'm a soldier bound for glory. I'm a soldier going home. Come and hear me tell my story. All who love the Savior come. I love Jesus, hallelujah. I love Jesus, yes I do. I love Jesus, he's my Savior. Jesus smiles and loves me too. I will tell you what induced me in the glorious fight to start. 'Twas the Savior's loving kindness overcome and won my heart. I love Jesus, hallelujah. I love Jesus, yes I do. I love Jesus, he's my Savior. Jesus smiles and loves me too. When I first commenced my warfare, many said he'll run away. But the words I've been unfounded in the fight I'm still today. I love Jesus, hallelujah. I love Jesus, yes I do. I love Jesus, he's my Savior. Jesus smiles and loves me too. I'm a wonder unto many, God alone the change has wrought. Here I raise my Ebenezer, hither by his help I'm brought. I love Jesus, hallelujah. I love Jesus, yes I do. I love Jesus, he's my Savior. Jesus smiles and loves me too. When to death's dark swelling river, like a warrior I shall come. Then I mean to shout salvation and go singing glory home. I love Jesus, hallelujah. I love Jesus, yes I do. I love Jesus, he's my Savior. Jesus smiles and loves me too.
Must get it right. We're looking in 1 Timothy chapter 3, verses 14 through 16. We must get it right. And if you would please stand in honor of God's word as we read this together, this passage of scripture to begin with. 1 Timothy chapter 3. Hopefully I have the book right. Hopefully I have the chapter right. Probably not. Call it out if I keep making those mistakes. But 1 Timothy chapter 3, verse 14. You go to the next slide, Julie. Here we go. It says, these things write unto thee. So this is Paul writing to Timothy, who's the pastor at Ephesus, who Paul has left there to pastor the churches, to pastor the church at Ephesus and to lead them. And he's writing this, and he says in 1 Timothy chapter 3, verse 14, these things write unto thee, hoping to come unto thee shortly. But if I tarry long, that thou mayest know how thou oughtest to behave thyself in the house of God, which is the church of the living God, the pillar and the ground of the truth. And without controversy, great is the mystery of godliness. God was manifest in the flesh, justified in the spirit, seen of angels, preached unto the Gentiles, believed on in the world, received up into glory. Let's go in prayer together. Father, as always, we thank you for your word, the power of your word. God, as we look for truth, as we look for hope, as we look for love in this world, we find it nowhere. We have this sense that we need it. We long for it. But we don't find it anywhere. As we sang earlier, hope has a name. Not only is there hope, and it's a miracle that there is hope for us as sinners, but we have hope. Not only is there hope, but hope has a name, and it's Jesus Christ. Love has a name. God, you are love. Love has a name. Hope has a name. God, joy has a name. God, I pray we could see that this morning, that God, we would be moved by these things. That God, I feel that you would hit every one of us this morning with your Holy Spirit. That you would revive us. And God, if we're dead, that you would bring us to life. And God, if we're alive, but our vigor and our zeal and our passion has died down, God, fan that flame. Kindle that flame. Revive us again. God, we want to be passionate about what we're doing. We want to see the importance of what we're doing. Help us to see that this morning with fresh eyes.
Help us to hear this morning through your word, through your spirit, not what I can say. God, my words fall. They're empty. I'm not persuasive. My opinions fall short. They're faulty. They're fallible, mistaken. But God, we want to hear from you and from your word this morning. Hear the power of your word, the power of your spirit speaking to us this morning, that we would be obedient to you in whatever each one of us need to do this morning. But again, we thank you for this time and pray for the filling of your Holy Spirit, the presence of your Holy Spirit here this morning. We pray and ask all these things now in Jesus' name. Amen. Be seated. As I read this passage of Scripture, I don't know how seriously you take this place we're at this morning, or how seriously you take what we do here. I don't know. I know from the outside, there are people who probably drive by this building every day and don't even see it. They probably would take this place really lightly, just a little country church. Just a little country church. There are a lot of people who would look at this and take this very lightly. Maybe they would see this as irrelevant. They would, or even wouldn't even give it the time to comment. They would just ignore it. Ignore this meeting here at Marble Hill Baptist Church. Or maybe a mentality, and this might get closer in the stream, might be a take it or leave it. Sure. Go to church. If you want me to go to church, you know, maybe you're here this morning, you're here because someone else makes you be here. And you're willing to go, but you really may not have a desire and a passion to be here. That's the way I was for years and years. Even after I became a Christian, I didn't want to go to church. I was there, but my heart wasn't there. I didn't want to be there. So somebody take this fairly. So I don't know as I speak to this room, but I'll say this. Just by virtue of you being here this morning, I'm going to assume that what we do here matters at least to some degree to every person in this room. Or you wouldn't be here on a rainy Sunday morning. Just by virtue of you being here this morning, I'm going to assume that what we do here matters somewhat to you. But in this text, and in many, many others like it, I get a sense for how serious God takes what we do here. Look at verse 15. But if I tarry long, that thou mayest know how thou oughtest to behave thyself in the house of God, in the house of God, which is the church of the living God. And this is the church in Ephesus. This is, of course, the body of Christ, but this is a single local church. Not how you should behave yourself in the body of Christ universally, but how you should behave yourself in the house of God, this local assembly, like just like this church right here, which is the church of the living God. Marble Baptist Church is the church of the living God. Listen to what it says next. The pillar and ground of the truth. What a statement. The pillar and ground. There are other translations that might say the buttress of the truth. A defensive wall upon the truth, a foundation of the truth. What a statement. The church of the living God, the pillar and ground of the truth. If you're not aware, we are in a war today over the truth. What's the truth? We are in a war today for the truth. And not what I'm saying, but what the Holy Spirit is saying through the pen of the Apostle Paul, who met Jesus Christ face to face, resurrected, is saying that we are the church of the living God, the pillar and ground for the truth. And this church of the living God, the pillar and ground for the truth, must stand. We have to take a stand. We have to stand. I think we sang that in that song, A Beautiful Life. And so for God, I raised my hand and said, and so for God, I'll take my stand. Each day I'll lend a helping hand. We have to take a stand for the truth. And it must not be compromised. And understand this, there's a million ways to compromise the truth. But the truth cannot be compromised. I also want to mention this. The details matter. And we have a great example of that conveniently in verse 16. And that's what Paul, that's why he wrote all the entire letter of 1 Timothy is about the church. It's about elders and deacons. That's what's in this chapter before. It's about how we are to conduct ourselves in the house of God and outside of the house of God. It's all about the church. And Paul writes this letter and writes other letters because the details matter. What we do matters. What we do and how we do it, it matters. The details matter. And to give you an example, I look at verse 16. You'll notice it's worded a little bit weird. It's worded a little bit strange. Yes, Paul's writing, and there's a certain flow to what he's saying. And then he says, and without controversy, great is the mystery of godliness. God was manifest in the flesh, justified in the spirit, seen of angels, preached unto the Gentiles, believed on in the world, received up into glory. The cadence of what he's saying changes there. It's worded a little bit strange on how Paul is recording this. I wonder if that matters. Why is it that way? And does it even matter? It does matter. It mattered to me on Monday. It mattered to me this past... It's kind of like, you know, you go to school and you're like, well, you sit in algebra class, you say, when are you ever going to use this in real life? You hear somebody say that? Have you ever said that? Teacher, when are we ever going to use this in real life? Who cares if we get this right or not? And if we're not careful, that mentality comes here to say, well, when am I ever going to use the fact that this was an early church creed in real life? I used it on Monday. Not this particular passage, but this literally came up. This is an early church creed. Paul is inspired by the Holy Spirit to pin this creed down, but this creed did not originate with Paul. This predated him. And there's in other of Paul's writings, he'll break into a creed. He does that in 1 Corinthians chapter 15 that predated him. Now that's extremely important because what does this creed say? God was manifest in the flesh. That's saying that Jesus was God. Okay? Now hang with me on this. I'm going to tell you why this is so important. It's saying that Jesus was God and he was justified in the Spirit. He was vindicated in the Spirit. His claim to be God was backed up. How? Through the power of the Holy Spirit. Think about his baptism. What happened after his baptism that never happened before his baptism? When the Holy Spirit descended upon him, he goes into the wilderness. What happens after that? Miracles happen through the power of the Holy Spirit. Saying, this is God, this is God, feeding the 5,000, opening blinded eyes, healing the lepers, walking on water, raising the dead. The Spirit is testifying, saying, this is truly God. God has become manifest. God has taken on flesh. When we celebrate that at Christmas, the incarnation, the Holy Spirit vindicated that claim of Jesus to be, I and the Father are one. Before Abraham was, I am. When he said that he is God, it was vindicated by the Spirit through miracles, the greatest of which was his own resurrection 3 days after he was crucified. The greatest miracle, vindicating, saying this truly was God, the Son of God, was made manifest. It goes on, and so it says, God was manifest in the flesh. He was justified in the Spirit. He was seen of angels. What's that talking about? When he was born, did angels show up, true or false? Yes or no? His birth was announced by angels. His resurrection was announced by angels. He was watched over. Satan came to him and said, throw yourself off the pinnacle of the temple. Before it is written, he shall give his angels watch over thee that you will not dash your foot against a stone. Angels watched over him. Angels announced his birth. He was seen of angels. Angels announced his resurrection. They found an empty tomb and an angel saying, why are you looking for the living among the dead? Seen of angels, preached unto the Gentiles. He's been now preached, he's not just the Jewish Messiah, he's been preached to the nations. He is the Jewish Messiah, yes, but he is also the Savior of the world. And he's been believed on in the world. Those nations are being saved because he is the Savior of the world. And at the end of his life, after his resurrection, 40 days later, he was received up into glory. He ascended back to the Father. And I think that's a little reference to the fact because when he ascended back to the Father, you know what the angel said then? As the angels testified to that? Why are you standing around like a gazing stock? Do you not know the same Jesus shall return? Who you've seen ascend shall return in like manner. It's a little reference to the second coming and that he ascended. Now let me tell you why that is so essential. When was 1 Timothy written? 500 AD? 300 AD? The date of when this was written matters. 65 AD. 35 years after the events this was written, the creed already existed. Because they didn't have a Bible then, so they had creeds. It would help them remember the gospel. They would remember a creed like this. That's the whole gospel contained in this creed. People could go to church on one Sunday or in one meeting, and they could memorize this creed and go and share the gospel with others. That is the story of Jesus. That is the gospel contained. And so it predates 65 AD. Paul is quoting this creed in approximately 65 AD. Does that matter? Yes. Why does it matter? You can ask me that, Jordan. Why does that even matter? Why are you spending time on this? Jesus is not a legend.
Amen.
On Monday, I had a friend tell me, I think the things about Jesus are legendary. I said, I don't think they are. I think it's maybe like other stories we tell our children. You know, this guy actually lived. St. Nicholas lived, I'll just say that. But I think that legends grew later on that are fictional. I said, I don't think that's what you have here. In fact, I think it's almost terrifyingly different than that, because all the craziest things about Jesus were reported within the lifetime of those who were eyewitnesses. 35 years may sound like a long time when they begin to pin these things out, when we have the writings, but that creed was already spreading within just a few decades of this, and probably within a few years. You have this early creed that's spreading. The craziest things about Jesus were told within the lifetimes of those who witnessed it. This is not legend, it's history. Does that matter? Holy smokes, it matters. Nothing matters more. Yes, it matters. Jesus is not a legend. The Gospels are not legend, they're history. They're eyewitness accounts of true events that happened. There was no time for legends to grow about Jesus. It's within the lifetime of those who experienced it and witnessed it and bore witness to it. And this little creed here is a detail and a clue that proves this. And I say all that to say this, the details matter. Understand the details of this book matter tremendously. Amen. I hope you're reading it. I hope you're studying it. You say, well, I don't like to read. I hate reading. This book's on a different level. Even for those who hate reading, if you understand what this book is, you read it anyway. Even if you hate to read, I've never read a novel in my entire life. I never will read a novel, but I read this book from front to back over and over and over. I spend hundreds of hours, thousands of hours in this book because this is different. This is definitely different. And the details matter. I've got to pore over the details. I've got to read that passage again and say, man, I misremembered that. I've got to make sure that I'm poring over those details and reading them closely. And you have to do the same. I'm doing that as a pastor, especially as a pastor, but I'm doing that as a Christian. I'm basing my entire eternity upon this book. The details matter. And I also say this, and the title of this message, we must get it right. We have to get it right. We must be precise in how we read and preach and share God's word. Again, all of 1 Timothy is about the church, how the church should be set up, how we should conduct ourselves in the house of God and outside the house of God, how we should live our lives as members of the church of the living God. The pastors and deacons met at this church yesterday for 3 hours, over 3 hours. We would have met longer, but I'd take Vera to work, so I had to leave. And I hated to leave because we would have probably met for another hour. Everybody got lucky because Vera had to go to work, so we finally cut it off. But we met about how we can care for people better. How can we care for people? How can we care for this congregation better? How can we care for those who come in better? How can we serve better? How can we love better? How can we be a better witnesses to the world? Over 3 hours, that may sound excessive. It's not. Why? Because we must get it right. We have to get it right. There's no room for error. We have to get it right. Leander works over for a company called Standard Aero. He works on jet engines. Bill has worked in the aircraft industry for decades, aviation industry for decades. in that field, it's not about speed, and it's not about efficiency. I remember Lander, when he started working at Standard Oil, he was recounting this to me. It's a different world than working at a car dealership, working on cars. I mean, there's a push. We only got 8 hours billable for this task. You got to get it out. You got to crank it out. But it was completely, was it completely different when you went to Standard Aero, Lander? Completely different. Well, you still got, yeah, there's, you still, it is a factor. But the number one priority is not volume, is not turnover, it's not production. You know what it is? It's precision. Because here's the thing, it has to be exactly right. It has, Bill, does it have to be exactly right? You're working on, Lander can make a multi-million dollar mistake. And it gets even worse than that. These are jet engines. A car engine fails, it could be dangerous, but you coast over the side of the road, you're broke down. When a jet engine fails, people could die. It has to be exactly right. Precision matters. Honesty matters. If you drop a part, what do you have to do, Lander? You have to go tell somebody. Anybody see it? Nobody saw it. Doesn't matter. That part could kill somebody. You have to go say, I dropped this part. It's a stainless steel part. It fell 2 feet. I'm sure it's fine. The stakes are too high. You have to get it reinspected. It may be taken out of service. It may be a $10,000 part, but it's taken out of service because that could cost people their lives. It's literally life and death. Life or death mistakes can be made. Ask the folks at Boeing. Close enough. Others can relate to this. In life, everyone has safety things where they work. I think about nurses. I think about Ty with his crew. If his guys say, did you wait eat that back part? Close enough. How long are they going to work for you if they say, yeah, close enough? How about your customers, at these luxury car dealerships? They don't accept close enough. Bill's one of the most loving men I've ever met. Ty's a loving man too. Lander's a loving man. But Bill's one of the most loving men I've ever met. But I can tell you, if someone keeps coming to you and they work on an engine and they mess it up, they say, that's close enough. How long are they going to work for you?
About another minute.
I thought Bill was a loving guy. He's firing people just because they said close enough. Because he's a loving man, that can't be tolerated. You can get somebody killed, so this guy's your friend. So you don't have to, go through the process of hiring a new employee. I'm saying all that, we could say much more, but listen, this morning, I'm not being dramatic, I'm not exaggerating. When it comes to what we do with Christ, with the Word of God, within the Church of God, it is astronomically more important that we are precise and we must get it right. I feel like Christians should have a reputation that if they were to ask you, you go to work on million-dollar parts where lives are on the line, you go to perform brain surgery, you're in the military, whatever field you're in, you go in and they say, let me tell you something. Close is not good enough. It has to be exactly right. And you could reply to them and say, that's perfectly fine because I'm a Christian. Let me tell you something. I understand exactly right. I'm a Christian. It is astronomically more important that we are precise and that we must get it right. Lives are not at stake here. Eternities are at stake with what we do. Not losing your life at the age of 30, losing your eternity forever if we get this wrong. We cannot get it wrong. We can't. We have to get it exactly right. Eternities are at stake. What will happen to us and to others forever? We, Marble Hill Baptist Church, must get it right. Close isn't good enough. There's no fudging it. We can't tweak it. We can't fudge it. It has to be exactly right. Revelation chapter 2. Y'all turn over there. Verses 1 through 3. Revelation chapter 2, verses beginning with verse 1. It's interesting, this is the same church, probably 30 years later. Jesus is talking to this church. I want you to understand, Jesus knows all about Marble Hill. He knows our character. He knows our integrity. That's a scary thought. He knows everything about us. There's nothing hidden from him. He's here. He knows what's going on. He knows what's going on in here. He knows what's going on in here. He sees through us. He knows everything. He was keenly aware of the church at Ephesus. He knew all about it. And he dictates this letter through John, and John had spent time at Ephesus. Paul was writing to Timothy, who was at the church at Ephesus. And this is what he says. Unto the angel of the church at Ephesus write, these things saith he that holdeth the seven stars in his right hand and walketh in the midst of the seven golden candlesticks. It's talking about the pastors. It's talking about the candlesticks, the churches that are the light of the world. That's Jesus who holds these things in his hand. He says to the church at Ephesus, I know thy works and thy labor and thy patience and how thou canst not bear them which are evil. And thou hast tried them that say they are apostles and are not, and hast found them liars. And hast borne and hast patience for my name's sake, hast labored and hast not fainted. The church at Ephesus, according to Jesus, was a hard-working, faithful church that took a stand upon the truth. And that's what they were. If Jesus says that's what they are, that's what they are. All of this is true. Jesus is incapable of giving a false testimony. He can only give a true testimony. And that's what he says about the church at Ephesus. And they had done this for decades at this point. This was 30 years after Paul is writing to Timothy at Ephesus. 3 decades later. And they are commended by Jesus. By Jesus himself is commending them for this. I wonder what he would say about us. I hope to God he would commend us. I want to be a commendable church. Not to the world. I would say, not even to you all, but to Christ. I want to be commendable to him. What he said, what people's opinions don't matter. His opinion matters. His opinion is the truth. We work for one. What he thinks about us matters, is everything. And I'll say this, verse 2, let me tell you the irony of the age we're living in. We've got to be so careful. There are people who would read verse 2 and they would say it's unchristian. I know thy works and thy labor and thy patience, and how thou canst not bear them which are evil. And thou hast tried them which say they are apostles and are not, and you found them to be liars. Well, that's not very Christ-like. That's not very Christian. Oh, you hate? You think people are liars? That's not very Christian, is it? Christ said it. Make sure you have a biblical view of Christ. Not a popular culture view of Christ. Christ says when something is a lie, we need to identify it as a lie. When something is false, when something is evil, we have to call evil, evil. We have to call falsehood, falsehood. We have to. And he commends that. And it is Christ-like because he did the same thing and he got crucified for it. But this church was a hard-working church that took a firm stand upon the truth and had done so for decades. But listen to this in verses 4 and 5. Now think about our church. We will celebrate 75 years. 75 years as a church this year. Since 1948, is my math right? Okay, I'm probably wrong on that. Don't let me do math on the fly. 75 years. But look at Revelation chapter 2, verses 4 through 5. Nevertheless, you've been faithful. You've stood for the truth. You've endured. They probably endured persecution and suffering for the name of Christ. But I have somewhat against thee. because thou hast left thy first love. You've left your first love. But then he doesn't just stop there. He tells them what to do about it. Remember. Remember, therefore, from whence thou art fallen, and repent. Remember the love you used to have, and repent, and do the first works. Go back to doing what you were doing with that first love, or else I will come into thee quickly, and I will remove thy candlestick. The light goes out. Hey, keep meeting. Keep meeting, keep coming, keep congregating, keep having a budget, keep me, but the light's gone. And let me promise you, there are churches today, Christian churches, from where the light has been removed. They have no light. I sat in one this week. I mean, this is real practical stuff. I sat in one this week, the light had gone out. I sat in darkness in a Christian church. That can happen here. We can't think that can't happen here. Or else I will come to thee quickly, and I will remove thy candlestick out of its place, except thou repent. I think about this for our church. Have we left our first love? Think about that. Not just as a church, but as Christians. And a lot of times as I'm preaching here, you know, I'm preaching for people to be saved. I want people to be saved. I want them to come to know the Lord. But this is more for, raise your hand and keep your hand up. If you've been a Christian for more than 10 years, raise your hand in this church. Or not just in this church, but if you've been a Christian for more than 10 years, raise your hand. 20 years. You're probably older than you think, if that helps. 20 years. 30 years. 40 years. Okay, my hand comes down. 50 years. 60 years. 70 years. We got two still going over here. That's how many years have y'all been, if you can do the math quickly in your head? 71. 71 years. How many, Pat? 72. 72 years. All right. Amen. That's tremendous. They're still here. Like Bill was singing that song earlier, here they are. Probably people said, well, I don't know if they really got saved or not. Maybe things happened in their life. They're still here. That's tremendous. But I want to challenge those who's, the longer our hands stayed up, I want to challenge myself, 30 years, a Christian. This is for us old timers who've done this for so long. We're more capable than anybody of going through the motions. I know how to do it. I think I could get up here and preach a message completely in the flesh. I could do it. But I think you could probably tell. I could hit the 3 points. I could do those things. I could have the scripture. But I think you could tell. I would certainly be able to tell. But we that have been Christians the longest, we can go through the motions. We can come in here with our body and we can sing and our heart can be somewhere else. What I'm saying this morning is we cannot become complacent. I want you to see what Christ is saying here. I mean, these are some folks at the church at Ephesus have probably been Christians for decades. The first century of Christians, the first generation of Christians. But I want you to see there is no coasting to the finish line. We can leave our first love. Our love can grow cold. My love can grow cold. That is a possibility. So what was that first love? It was Christ. And it was love. That is, I promise you, it doesn't go into detail, that was their first love. It was Christ, it was love. It was love for Christ. It was love for their neighbor. It was even love for their enemy. Justin's spending weeks on that in our Sunday school class right now. It was love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. Love your neighbors yourself. They had departed from it. They were still taking a hard stand on the truth. They were still working hard, taking a stand, but they had left their first love. Love for Christ, love for their neighbors. How about love for souls? Let me ask you this. How excited do you get when you hear about somebody getting saved? How excited do you get? Did you used to get more excited? Have you become cynical to say, yeah, I don't know. Man, I hope not. That's leaving your first love. The longer we are Christians, the more excited we should get when we hear that somebody's been saved. how excited you get when you hear that someone has repented and rededicated their life to Christ. To hear that someone is growing in their faith and in their knowledge. Do you root for people? Or you just see them as problems? I'm guilty of that. I see that. With people come problems. If we're not careful, we see people as problems. That cannot be. As we close this morning, I'll ask everybody to stand if you would. Ask Bill to come get a song. I'll say it again this morning. We must get it right. The last scripture I'm going to look at, Luke chapter 15. Luke chapter 15. It says, then drew near unto him all the publicans and sinners for to hear him. Tax collectors, sinners, they were coming to Jesus, and the Pharisees and the scribes, you can translate scribes, the experts in the law. Those aren't newbies. Those are folks that have been in the Jewish religion probably their whole life. The Pharisees and the scribes murmured, saying, this man receiveth sinners and eateth with them. And he spake this parable to them, saying, you know, those Pharisees and those scribes, there might have been a time in their life when there was some sincerity there. But that was gone. Listen to this parable. Jesus says, what man of you, having 100 sheep, if he lose one of them, doth not leave the 99 in the wilderness and go after that which is lost until he find it? And when he hath found it, he lays it on his shoulders, rejoicing. And when he cometh home, he called together his friends and neighbors, saying to them, rejoice with me, for I have found my sheep which was lost. I say unto you, that likewise joy shall be in heaven over one sinner that repenteth, amen, more than over 99 just persons which need no repentance. I'm saying all that this morning to say this. When it comes to Jesus Christ, to the Word of God, to the gospel, to the truth, and when it comes, most importantly, to love, all of those equally important, when it comes to this church, we must get it right. Not close. We have to get it exactly right. And I want you to understand something. You can't fake love. You cannot fake love. It's a fruit of the Spirit. It is the fruit of the Spirit. You cannot fake love. We must get love right. All of us, myself included, must examine ourselves. Have we left our first love? Has our love grown cold? Have we gotten sloppy or lazy when we must be precise? You tell me. As we sing, I've asked people if we can sing this song, Love Lifted Me. Only reason I'm here today wasn't my love, it was the love of Christ lifted me. I love the little phrase in this song, love lifted even me. Love, unbelievable. We have to get love right. As we sing this, if you need to come and pray, I encourage you to come. I'm done. Let the Holy Spirit work now. If He's speaking to you, you need to come and pray. Pray. If you need to pray at your seat, pray at your seat. If you need to sing from your seat, thanking God that He lifted you. I was on my way to hell. But then Christ miraculously intervened, and He grabbed me, and He lifted me. That's why the only reason, in Christ alone, the only reason I'm here today is because of the love of Christ. Christ lifted me in love. Let's sing this together.